My idea was simple. A case that not only protects your AirPods, but also converts the charging port from the old Lightning connector to USB-C, so that you only need to use one cable ever again. But in the age of AI startups created overnight stealing all the spotlight in the news, what is possible today for a hardware company that has only one employee? In the first 5 days after launch, I received over 1,000 orders, and well, this is how I was able to produce them all by myself. Okay, so on my last video, the comment section got pretty heated about me buying a sandblasting robot. But why? Let's say you launch a new product and you have no idea how many you're gonna sell. Is it gonna be 10, 100, 1,000? So the conventional method to produce plastic parts is to do injection molding. You cut a steel or aluminum mold, and then with a big machine, you inject melted plastic in the mold. That's great because each part will cost pennies. That's true. But what about the mold? Well, let's take the case production file, send it to someone on Alibaba and ask for the price of a mold. $15,000. That's more than the sandblasting robot already. But here's the kicker. I want to make a case for 6 different models that all have 3 separate parts. You see what I mean? I need to make a mold for each part. With just this argument, I pretty much don't have a choice already. The product needs to be 3D printed. You'll see as the video progresses, that fact becomes clearer and clearer. And well, turns out I already have an SLS 3D printer that is perfect for that job. You can have a look at the video when I received it to get familiar with it. But basically, it prints by sintering together very fine powder, and you can get very strong parts with great resolution. They look way better than what you would have with those conventional filament printers.
Okay, so now the product launches, orders are coming in, but my stock was tiny compared to the demand that was coming in. That's a great problem to have, but it's still a problem.
So here my strategy at the beginning was to focus on one product at a time. I import the file for that product, lock the orientation because I want all the cases to have the same look and physical properties, and then I try to find how many I can fit in one case height. For this model, it's 7 cases. Then the beauty of this SLS 3D printing technology finally shows. There are no printing supports. I can just array all this in the Z-axis, I press print, and off it goes. It adds a layer of powder, the laser solidifies the plastic where the parts are, then adds another layer of powder, you get the idea. While it's printing, I don't need to watch it or anything. I can just do customer service and work on the electronics that goes inside the case.
So the case is not just plastic, we've got this little electronic circuit that I make that goes inside. And so basically I get those raw PCBs from PCBWay, shout out to them. And then I've got this whole like setup area where I do the paste, pick and place and reflow soldering. But I think that's gonna be another video. I still wanna upgrade this setup a little bit.
Okay, so there's another cool thing I wanna show you about the slicer. Let's say the huge rush of orders is finished and now I only want to print on demand. I wrote this little Python script that takes as input the orders I haven't shipped yet from a spreadsheet, counts how many of each model I need, plus a small buffer, and loads them in a slicer. But here's where the real magic happens. I select everything with Command A, hit Pack Selected Models, and boom, everything's arranged perfectly and I can just hit print to make exactly what I need. I also get all the data on how much powder I can reuse, which is neat.
I usually start my prints in the morning, and now 12 hours later in the evening, it's finished printing. So there's 70 cases in there. That's 210 different parts. I'm gonna take out the build chamber now and let it cool overnight in the sieve station. The really interesting thing here is that you can buy a second build chamber and swap them immediately and start printing overnight. So I can pretty much double my printing speed from 70 cases to 140 cases per 24 hours.
Okay, it's the next day and we can see that the build chamber has fully cooled down in the sieve station. I press the up button and the cake comes out. Now it's a bit of a trade-off because you want to try to save as much powder as you can, but you also don't want to spend too much time doing this. Yes, you can reuse the powder, and thank God for that because it's not exactly cheap, but time and tired fingers aren't cheap either. I
I tried using a power tool with a brush to speed things up, but I haven't found the perfect brush for me yet. Also, kudos to Formlabs for releasing this glove box accessory that closes the front of the sift station. It was fine before because it has negative pressure, but it feels so much safer and quieter now. Now comes the sandblasting robot. It's called the Fuse Blast. It's so easy to use, it's like a dishwasher for 3D printed parts. You just dump them in and press start. Now you do need a relatively big compressor to use this machine. I previously only had this tiny one and oh boy was it loud. Now I've upgraded to this one and it's much quieter and powerful than the one I've had before. That's about the smallest compressor you can use with the blast machine. Before I was sandblasting manually and it was the biggest pain ever. My posture was awful looking down there and I don't even want to think how long it would have taken me to do 1,000+ parts by hand. The thing I really need to mention is that with the robot the finish quality is very uniform and great for commercial products, while by hand it's easy to get too close and make marks on your products. It just won't look professional. Now here we have it, a finished product. I think the layer lines on the front look really cool. I personally love the texture. It feels rugged and like it won't fall out of your hand. And it does become smoother and softer to the touch with time. The very vast majority of the feedback on the texture I received has been extremely positive. I think only 2 or 3 people told me they weren't a fan, but hey, fair enough. I don't think it's possible to make a product that everyone would love.
Or is it? Maybe the solution is to make variants so that customers can choose the version that's perfect for them.
Now that I've got 6 base products dialed in, I think I'm ready to expand. So judging from all the messages I received, a lot of people want a lanyard version. Well, here comes the power of 3D printing again. I don't need to cut another mold. I just duplicate the design for all my cases and add a lanyard loop to them. And yeah, I'm adding this version to the shop right now if you're interested. It comes with a small keyring. Okay, now we have 17 different parts, but with the lanyard, it adds another 4 different parts. So we are now at 21 different plastic parts. It's becoming more and more complex. So if I want to make sure that I don't get lost in my logistics, I need some type of storage system. Right now, I just track the stock quantities in a spreadsheet and store each part separately in one of those IKEA boxes. The real interesting thing here is that you can add parametric text on each part in your design software, and that means you can engrave in a design file the version of that file and it will print it at the same time. So one example of why this is very useful, when I started shipping the cases, a few people got back to me saying the case wasn't working. And I was really surprised, you know, because I test every single one before shipping. But then I found out it was just a tolerance issue and I needed to push down the connector by 0.5 millimeter so that it would work for everyone. So I just changed the design while I was producing and the part number also changed. Now if someone has a problem, I can just ask them what number they have and it's easier for me to keep track of issues. Let's see if we can make something for those few people that didn't like the texture. There's something I've always wanted to try. It's called the texture engine. You place your file and it adds texture to faces you've chosen in your design. That's really useful because it's quite hard and inefficient to add those textures yourself with engineering design software. You can try your own displacement maps, but here I think I've got plenty to work with already. Now let's print those and see what it looks like. Yeah, okay, looks pretty cool. But here's the last thing I wanted to show you for today. It's called the polishing kit. So it's basically an add-on that I can plug in a Fuse Blast robot. So you've got this little tank where you add tap water and a polishing agent. You swap the nozzle. And instead of blasting 200 micron glass beads at the 3D parts, it blasts those slightly larger plastic beads and creates a smooth, polished finish. It's super easy to swap it. You need a stronger compressor for this and the cycle in the blast also takes longer. I've ran the same parts as before through that polishing cycle and here's how they turned out. What do you think? Let me know if you've got a favorite and I might start stocking it too. It definitely feels smoother and it's got a little shine to it too. There's so much more stuff I could talk about. I also want to address coloring, but that'll probably be for another time. See you soon, bye.